Good afternoon and welcome to today's webinar entitled COVID-19, Interacting with Individuals Who Are Deaf or Hard of Hearing. This webinar is hosted by the University of Wisconsin-Madison, Division of Extension Health and Wellbeing Institute, in partnership with the Wisconsin Department of Health Services, Office for the Deaf and Hard of Hearing. The COVID-19 pandemic has introduced new common safety practices, including face coverings and social distancing. However, these practices also cause communication barriers for people who are deaf and hard of hearing. Today, we are joined by colleagues from the Office for the Deaf and Hard of Hearing who will provide basic communication strategies for interacting more comfortably with individuals who are deaf or hard of hearing. Thank you for joining our conversation. My name is Emily Latham, and I am the Health Communications Outreach Specialist for the Division of Extension Health and Wellbeing Institute. I would like to take a moment to introduce our presenters today. Bette Mentz-Powell is a senior level human services program coordinator for the Office for the Deaf and Hard of Hearing. She holds a master's degree in rehabilitation counseling psychology from UW-Madison and is licensed by the state of Wisconsin as an independent social worker and a professional counselor. She has worked in her current position in the Department of Health Services for the past 36 years. Caroline Lutka has been with the Office for the Deaf and Hard of Hearing since 2014. She obtained a master's degree in vocational rehabilitation counseling, specialized to work with deaf and hard of hearing caseloads from the University of Arkansas at Fayetteville. Serving the deaf, deafblind, and hard of hearing people has been her passion for the past 16 years. And Jennifer Anderson has been with the Office for the Deaf and Hard of Hearing since January 2016. She obtained her Bachelor's of Arts degree from Metropolitan State University and her Master's degree in Social Gerontology from Bethel University. American Sign Language interpretation today is provided by Carly Beery and Maria Kilma from the Office for the Deaf and Hard of Hearing. Before we jump into today's content, I'd like to make note of a few housekeeping items. So all of our participant mics are muted. Please use the Q&A function for all questions that you would like to have answered. The chat feature allows you to send questions to specific individuals. So for example, if you have a tech issue, you can please chat that to Chelsea Severin. For each presenter, we will spotlight the videos of the presenter and the interpreter so that you can see them in addition to the slideshow. We will address questions at the end, but please feel free to send questions anytime during the presentation. Just use that Q&A feature so that we can keep them all organized. Questions will be viewable to the presenters only, whereas the chat can be viewable to all participants. And a recording of this webinar will be posted for review following this session on Extension's COVID response page. All registered participants will be notified of the recording and provided with additional resources early next week. So today we started with welcome and introductions, and the main portion of our presentation will include an overview of deaf and hard of hearing along with communication strategies. We'll also save 10 minutes at the end of the hour for a question and answer session with our panelists. And now I'd like to turn it over to our first presenter, Bette Mentz-Powell.
May I have the next slide, please? Hello, everybody, and welcome. I usually go on and on and on and on, and I've been told that we have a very short time together today, so I'm going to get right to it. The first part I want to talk to you about is that as we read for about the objectives of this training, we want to make you feel more comfortable in your interactions with deaf and hard of hearing people. So I think I'm going to start by asking you a question before I start talking. Could I have the next slide, please? This will be a poll question. Can I have a poll question, please? There we go. Thank you. Looks like a race is going on. It's interesting. I think we're done. 22% said, yes, you've had some contact at work with a deaf or hard of hearing person. 78%, if I can see right without my glasses, have said that you have not had any contact with a deaf or hard of hearing person. My guess is soon, if it hasn't happened yet, it will happen because of the sheer numbers of people that are living with a hearing loss. And I think if we had changed that question, do you know someone with a hearing loss? Have you communicated with someone with a hearing loss? Probably close to 100% would say yes, because if you know a person that's older, is losing their hearing as a result of the natural aging process, it's hard to find somebody that doesn't have hearing loss. They might not admit it, but they do have the loss. Thank you for the poll. Can we continue now? People ask me, well, okay, I work at the hospital, I work in a clinic, and I have so many people coming in, and why do I need to learn to communicate with deaf and hard of hearing people? I can't learn every single language there is in the world. Well, first of all, because it's the right thing to do. Secondly, because communication with the population is often just a matter of common sense. Thirdly, there is a law that requires communication access for people with a hearing loss. It's called the Americans with Disabilities Act. This is not a new law. I think it's 25 years old at least. And it mandates that effective communication must be provided to deaf and hard of hearing people. This may mean an interpreter, it may mean writing, it may mean text, it could mean typing, could mean many different things depending on the individual with the hearing loss. Can we have the next slide, please? What's the primary barrier? I can't believe how many times I've called an agency and said, I would like to work with you to help you to learn to remove the barriers that your agency, your clinic has. What do you mean? We have ramp. People going up and down on the ramp. What's the big deal? I can get, I have a brochure in Braille over here someplace. Let me see if I find a way. No, we're talking about a very specific group of people who have disability. And for these people, the barrier is communication. How do they access information in the environment? How do they access information from their healthcare providers? If they go to purchase insurance, they go to the bank, they go to the grocery store, how do they communicate with somebody? How do they hear about how the world works? How do they hear about laws and rules? How do they hear about COVID? So much of it's written, and a person that's deaf may use English as a second language. So written communication may not be accessible for them. We would like to help you learn to communicate better, more effectively with the population, and everyone will benefit from this. Next slide, please. What does excellent customer service look like when we're working with deaf and hard of hearing people? This is a great question because I think this is a goal for all of us. Number one, it's easy. Focus on the person. Don't think about the disability. Hearing loss is kind of a quirky disability because you can't see it. I have absolutely no hearing. I don't use hearing aids. I don't have a cochlear implant. I don't walk around with a big sign in my neck saying, DEAF! Watch out! I don't do that. Can't see that. And I talk, so you might not even know that I have a hearing loss. And because can't talk either. Because you can't see it, that is due to misconceptions. And when I tell somebody, I'm sorry, I understand you. What did you say? I'm deaf. They just jump away. They move away like, I've got a deaf person here and I don't know what to do with this person. What am I going to do? That's what we want to avoid. And I think, just forget about me being deaf. Look at me. Talk to me directly. Please write. So some people will do that. People move away from me quickly, and they don't know what to do the minute that they hear that I'm deaf. The other thing that they may do, once in a while they do this. Can you read my lips? I'm going to talk about that in a few minutes. Avoid assumptions. Just because your grandmother might read lips does not mean that the next person that you meet with a hearing loss can read your lips. Some deaf people sign, some deaf people don't. Some people, deaf people use voice, some don't. Some are hard of hearing and they may rely on technology to help them communicate. Some people are deaf blind. Some people are deaf and have other disabilities. Some deaf people are experts in English, others are not. I wish I had a list. I was able to give you a list, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, things that we could do and ways to communicate with deaf and hard of hearing people, but we can't because again, it depends on the individual. Please treat the person with hearing loss the same way you would anybody else. Would you do this for somebody that came in and has hearing? You would? Okay, then do the same thing for the deaf person. You might have to find a different way of doing it, but the whole goal is equality, equal services. Please be very patient because it may take longer when you're communicating with a deaf and hard of hearing person because first of all, it may take some time to figure out what it is that person needs. Next slide, please. What do you call someone with a hearing loss? These terms may be confusing. When we're talking about somebody who's deaf, we're talking about two things. One is their primary means of communication is visual. They rely on watching an interpreter, rely on reading. They might be trying to read lips and maybe relying on gestures, whatever is visual. The second part is person is deaf. They cannot discriminate your speech. Many deaf people have some residual hearing. They may hear a phone ringing and they may pick it up. And if you said, what's that person on the other end saying? They say, I can hear them talking, but I don't know what they're saying. To me, that person's deaf, they're not able to discriminate speech. Okay, so keep that in mind. A hard of hearing person can hear and understand speech with varying degrees of difficulty. That may mean many times we think it can happen anytime during the person's life. A hard of hearing person that's older may have a problem with high frequency sounds. That means women's voices, it can mean consonant sounds or high frequency. So if we said the word ma, ha, lock and cup, they person may be able to hear the vowel sound, the ah, but they don't know which of those words that I'm saying because of their hearing loss. They can't pick up on that frequency. A hard of hearing person may be in denial about their hearing loss as well. Particularly if they're older, they may say, oh, I don't have hearing loss. What? And they're screaming. Because they say it's really hard to be old in our society and it's really hard to have hearing loss. Nobody wants to, oh, I have hearing loss, I have hearing loss. the older. While I'm working with somebody that is a senior, I assume they have hearing loss. I just start writing to them immediately. I don't even ask because I know they're going to say, oh, I don't need that. I don't need that. But yeah, I said, okay, I'm just doing it for myself. Just bear with me. I keep writing. Pretty soon they have their nose in my page. And, oh, I didn't know that. I didn't know that. Can I take those papers home and read them, Jeff? Well, yeah. But I said, why don't you ask people to write? It makes it easier for you. And they said, oh, I can't. I don't want to bother them. People, as they become older, I become more assertive. We have people that are late deaf. I used to consider myself late deaf because I lost my hearing when I was 27. I grew up normal hearing. I went to college. I was an English teacher and I had got married to a hearing man. I had a hearing baby and pow, I became hearing deaf. I became deaf very, very quickly and completely. So the way I'm going to respond to the world is very different. Because at that time, I didn't know sign language. I could read, I could write, but I couldn't lip read English. And I thought, maybe sign language, maybe I'm dumb, I don't know. So what do? I was in shock. Different than somebody that's born deaf, grows up signing, grows up knowing other deaf people. We also have someone who's deafblind, who is somebody that has vision loss and also a hearing loss. Only 6% of the population are completely blind and completely deaf. So normally someone will have one or both hearing and sight. Okay, next slide, please. How do we know someone's losing their hearing? Think about people that you know, particularly if they're older. Think about what their behavior's like. They may frequently ask people to treat. What do you say? What? Anybody keeps saying, what? And like, oh my God. My late husband, what? That was his favorite word. What? People want me to repeat because he doesn't understand. Somebody, I'm saying, maybe I'm talking to my ex-husband, and I say, okay, can you stop at the store and can you pick up a can of beans? And that, oh, okay. So he goes to the store and comes home with peas. I said, why do you get peas? Oh, I thought you said beans. Or how do you spell your name? And I said, oh, I like to crochet and knit. Well, they didn't understand what you were saying. For a person with a hearing loss, one-on-one is challenging. Am I going to understand that one person that I'm communicating with? And each time you add an additional person, communication challenge becomes more complex. Very difficult for a person with a hearing loss to function in a group setting. You may notice a person that's watching your mouth or trying to read lips. They're really wanting you. And they might be mouthing back what you're saying or what they think you're saying. We have this. Somebody has a good ear, or they think they have a good ear, and they turn it in. They may have a puzzled expression. They may go, when you're talking, and you might think, well, what's the matter? Maybe they're not understanding me, but maybe they're not hearing you accurately. The person may be talking too loudly. Or too soft like that to me. I think before I lost my hearing, I was loud, but no meaning to loud. I suspect I'm worse now. So when I'm with my friends or I'm with interpreters, if I go into a quiet place, I'd be really loud again. They don't say, shut up, keep your voice down. They say, it's very quiet in here. They're letting me know I play what the environment. Well, I continue being loud if I do, it's fine with them. But maybe, maybe I'm in church or maybe I'm in a quiet restaurant. maybe I don't want people to hear me, so they're giving me that information. Very common for people to completely withdraw and avoid social situations. Maybe somebody, couple, wife said, well, the older couple, my husband used to like play cards out there. We go every Saturday night. It was so much fun to play cards. And now he just got to stay home. He said, oh, I'm too tired. Or now I don't want to do this. I don't feel good. But I know if that's not the case, I don't know what's wrong. He doesn't want to go play cards because it's the fun part about playing cards. It's the social part of it. It's not the actual card playing, but it's chatting with people that are sitting at the table and then chatting with coffee afterwards. He can no longer take part in that. So, withdraws. Next slide, please. And this brings us to communication strategies. How are you going to communicate with somebody that you come in contact with? There are many different modes of communication we can use. And sometimes it's just hit and miss. Sometimes it's best idea maybe to ask the person, how do you want to communicate? We might use lip reading. We might use writing. Maybe natural gestures, which is good. If you're doing a test, a COVID test, you want them to move in their car. But suppose that you need to talk to them about the results. Those natural gestures are not going to work. Sign language interpreters and technology aids are also possible depending on the individual. Let's see, can we have poll number two? Interesting, because about 60% of the people said they have taken their masks down to help somebody understand. 40% said no. Honestly, I think some people contact me and say, I wish they'd just take their mask off because I need to understand them. They go to a doctor's appointment. I want the doctor to take his mask off. I want the nurse to take her mask off. No. That mask is there for reasons to keep you safe. And I think that we need to find a different way to communicate, which will be effective, but yet keep the person safe. So you might want to be thinking about that. Lip reading, can we go back to the communication slide? Let's move to the next slide. Good. I think the biggest myth related to hearing loss is that deaf and hard of hearing people are fantastic lip readers. Many hearing people think that. I'm here today to tell you that deaf and hard of hearing people can probably lip read about as well as you've done. And my guess is you're not great lip readers either, because it is a myth. Someone with some residual hearing, they can does have some hearing and they're watching somebody's lips, they might be able to pick up some things that way. But you could take somebody like myself, I have no residual hearing. There's just nothing there. I can't use a hearing aid or anything else. I'm a horrible lip reader. Yeah, I have a degree in English. I can read and write English. English is my first language. I've heard those words before. I've seen them on the list, but yeah, I can't lip read. And the issue is not with me not being smart or my brain not working. I don't have that skill. if that's about a deaf person who's never heard those words, that was born deaf, how would they interpret a language they never heard? How would you lip read Chinese? Do they get to do that? I would say 20% or less of the words in the English language are visible on the lips. And lip reading can create a lot of misunderstanding. Can we have the next slide, please? It's a skill that if you learn it, it has to be practiced. And some people never have that skill inside to get any better. I took 2 years of listening classes at UW Speech and Hearing Clinic after I lost my hearing. And I tested the same after 2 years as that walked in. What does that tell you? Many of the words in our language look the same. Think about the words penny, many, pay me, baby, maybe. They look the same. And even if we're not using words in isolation, we're using words, we'll say, well, if it's a phrase, we'll understand through context. Look at this one. Is anybody getting that up there? I can't see you. I'm guessing that. It looks exactly like this. I'm saying, where there's life, there's hope. Where's the lavender soap? Looks similar. This one looks like, do you like Fridays? Do you like fried eggs? Looks same. Then we have words that are totally invisible like this. I'll say it 5 times. Did you get it? The word is Indian. We don't say Indian. I love Indian food. We don't say that. We say Indian. I love Indian food. All the movement is inside my mouth, behind teeth. So I never expect anybody to lip read. If somebody is a good lip reader or they want to lip read, they will probably ask you. But please do not say, can you read my lips? Because that's setting them up for failure. Because if they say yes, then you're going to think, oh, right, they can lip read everything, blah, 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 blah. They're going to understand nothing. If they say no, then think, well, they understood that, so they're lying. Let them tell you what they can lip read. If somebody is dependent on lip reading, the masks are an issue, but we can transparent masks, which I think you've seen pictures of those, or maybe you have those. So there's a window mouth. We'll be talking about those in a few minutes. So keep in mind that a deaf person may not read lips any better than you do. Next slide, please. Writing may be a good option if the person uses English as first language. If they don't, they may read and write third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh grade level. It just varies. Some people are really proficient in written English. Some people are not. If you do write to a deaf person, think about keeping it simple. Don't go on one sentence. Print legibly so the person can understand. And it might be the best idea to do until an interpreter can actually arrive. Visual aids are always very helpful. And I think with COVID, there are probably a lot of visual aids that are available, so you might want to use that. So now I'm going to turn this over to speaker number 2. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. I'm going to be talking about American Sign Language. I use ASL. That's my primary language. And I rely on an interpreter to voice for me. So Carly is off the screen voicing for me today. So American Sign Language is a complete language. It is a visual gestural language, and it's based on the English language, but it's also its own language. So that means that ASL has its own grammar, its own syntax, and its own word structure order. And the idioms are definitely different from English to ASL. I think it's important for everyone to know that all deaf individuals that do not use ASL. So just keep that in mind. So when you meet a deaf person, don't assume that all of them are the same and speak the same language. Next slide, please. So I want to talk about qualified interpreters. And the interpreters in the state of Wisconsin have to be licensed under DSPS, Department of Safety and Professional Services. And the interpreters must be able to interpret effectively and accurately and impartially as well. And use specialized vocabulary as necessary pertaining to the specific job. And you definitely do not want to use a family member to be an interpreter. They're definitely not impartial. They have their own emotional perceptions and opinions related to anything. So it's really critical and important if you meet with a patient or a consumer that is deaf and uses American Sign Language to then get the appropriate interpreter that can be used for that appointment. Next slide, please. And there is a document, and you will be receiving this. And if you need to request or find a list of interpreters, this can help you find that information, and it's on the ODHH website. You can also contact our office at any time, and we can help you with that. We can provide information, where you can find interpreters located near you, and we can help and assist you with that. Next slide, please. So working with an interpreter, we've got some good tips for you. I see many people haven't actually experienced working with, a deaf individual before, and it can be a little bit awkward at first or uncomfortable. But just things to keep in mind that hopefully that will help you for the future to feel more comfortable if you should be in a situation. So a lot of times people ask if you should stand or sit. You should always actually be in front looking at the deaf person, and the interpreter will actually be near you. They will either be standing or sitting next to or a little bit behind you. So the deaf individual can see your face and your expressions and your body language, but then they're also going to be looking at the interpreter to get the information and the language that they need. So just be mindful of that you will have the interpreter standing or sitting next or near you. And then also just speak normally. Some people think that they have to stop, talk, ask the interpreter, are you following? Are you doing okay? The interpreter will be there and let you know if you're talking too fast or if you need to repeat something. Or the deaf individual will advocate for themselves as well and let you know that information. Next slide, please. And then remember just to speak directly to the deaf individual and look at them as well. So if the deaf person is signing, it's natural for a hearing person to actually look at the interpreter because the interpreter is using their voice, and hearing people usually look at each other. But it's good to practice. Remember that the deaf person is your patient or client, and a sign of respect would be that you maintain their eye contact and you're watching them and communicating directly with them. And also be mindful that the interpreter, there is a little bit of lag time. The interpreter has to take in the information from the deaf individual and then put that into an English language. So sometimes there might be a little bit of lag in the conversation. So it's just important to allow a little bit more extra time. Don't rush conversations or meetings. A typical, you know, doctor's appointment maybe take 15 minutes or so, but if a deaf individual and interpreter are involved, it might take a little bit more time, 20, 25 minutes or a little bit more time, just to make sure that you accommodate for that extra time allowed for those types of meetings. And if you're not sure what to do, don't feel embarrassed or afraid just to ask. You definitely can ask the deaf individual and say, is this working for you? Is this okay? Do I need to stand over here? How's the communication go? Just be upfront and ask the deaf individual. Next slide, please. There also are some other options as well. If the individual does not sign and does not use an interpreter or American Sign Language, or maybe an interpreter isn't available at that moment, there are other options that you can use as long as the other individual, deaf individual, is okay with that. So don't assume that they'll be okay with that. You want to make sure that you ask them first and make sure that they can decide what is best for them to be able to communicate with you. There's lots of different apps. There's a speech-to-text app, which are really great. And you also have to explore. Some are free. Some are free for limited time. Some are better for one-on-one conversations. So those are just some apps that you can explore to look at. You can also use notes as well. And you can do text message back and forth. But keep in mind that not everybody, they may not be able to read English if ASL is their first language. So having that back and forth written communication might not be best for everyone. It's definitely better for maybe a shorter conversation, but not a serious in-depth conversation. I would recommend using an interpreter for those situations. And then pocket talkers as well is another technology piece that can help, and other listening devices as well. So it's just good for people who use hearing aids or older individuals that have a hearing loss. The pocket talker definitely will help kind of amplify that communication. It looks like a Walkman, if you've ever seen those. It has a headphones and a microphone, and that's what it looks like. So you could invest in buying one for your office. There are many seniors with age-related hearing loss, and they don't wear the hearing aids, but they could benefit from something like a pocket talker. And again, like I said, you can contact our office. We've got definitely a longer list of resources than are here on the slide today. You know, we could give a presentation, a full day presentation on just this technology aids alone. Next slide, please. So video remote interpreting, VRI. This is used for when an interpreter is not available for on-site. And it's just another option of how to get an interpreter. And this is more of like a short notice or emergency situations. Next slide, please. And VRI is similar to a video conferencing technology. And that would be for off-site. An interpreter that is off-site can connect if they cannot be in person with you in the room. But it's important to know that you have to have high-speed internet for the connection to be clear to be able to use VRI services. And also, you need to make sure that you have really great video and audio quality. You do not want it to be choppy. You do not want the internet to cut out or the audio to cut out. That would not be effective for any kind of appointment you have. And just like Bette had mentioned earlier in the presentation too as well, this would be something that could be provided for individuals that would work as well. But there are some firewall issues too that you have to consider using VRI. Thinking about drive-through testing sites for COVID testing sites now, I don't know if they have internet access or not outside, but VRI could potentially be used in that situation. It just kind of depends where it's located and the quality of the internet. Next slide, please. And VRI should not be used in all situations, like I've mentioned. And it will not work for people with like a dual diagnosis, or if somebody has some type of vision loss. You know, we have received complaints that people have said, you know, I've gone into the clinic, I've tried to use the VRI, but I cannot see the interpreter on that small screen. So we just have to be mindful that it is not going to work for everybody and that effective communication might not work, especially if an individual has a dual hearing and vision loss. It is, though, a good technology to use if there are no live on-site interpreters available. Next slide, please. And then we have the website too here on how you can use that as well. Next slide, please. And then I will turn this over to Caroline to talk about telephone accommodations.
Hello, this is Caroline. We're going to talk about telephone. As you see in the picture here, the individuals who are deaf and hard of hearing, no matter the range of the hearing loss they have to choose of what type of device they can use as a telephone. You can see someone in the picture that you have someone has using an iPad or a cell phone, and they love to text. So there's two other pictures that you're probably wondering what those two phones are. The lower left corner is the one with the blue screen that you see a clock, it says 10 a.m. That is one example of a caption phone. Caption phone is very popular in the hard of hearing community because when they talk to somebody on the phone, they have a hard time understanding what's spoken. But this way, the communication assistant is actually typing, so they're providing captioning, so now they can see what's spoken. So it makes it very easy to have a phone conversation. So if you're one of those that likes to talk really fast, the captioning and trying to keep up, be mindful that there may be a delay before the consumer responds to your question. You won't know that they're using the caption phone unless the caller lets you know, I'm waiting for the captioning to finish. That kind of gives you a hint that it's the caption phone that they're using. Okay, the other phone on the lower right-hand corner is a bigger screen with a little circle on top as the camera. That it's one of the examples of a video phone. Video phone is very popular in the deaf community who uses sign language. Sign language is a visual language. So this allows individuals to see each other while communicating in ASL. And individuals who are deaf who want to call and make an appointment or they need to ask questions about COVID related, they're calling a hearing individual, a communication assistant will come on screen, the interpreter will help facilitate the call from ASL to English, English to ASL, and it makes it very smoothly. Next slide, please. So here are some telephone communication tips, because you never know who you're gonna speak to on the phone. And you're gonna notice that sometimes you're gonna run across somebody who may be frequently asking you to repeat. They want you to repeat and rephrase and they're having a hard time hearing, or they may respond inappropriately what you said. So here are certain tips. So first of all, most importantly, you want to have a conversation on the phone in a quiet environment. Noisy environment makes it very difficult to hear on the phone. I am hard of hearing. I do wear hearing aids in both ears. Background noise gets picked up a lot easier than speech. And it's very hard to follow. So if you are calling someone who has a hearing loss, especially if a senior citizen, age-related hearing loss, most of them may not have hearing aids, or they may not be aware that they do have a hearing loss. And you gotta communicate with them. I have noticed that when I call out and return a phone call, it is important to say a few things, allow them to just to hear you, especially if they're new to wearing hearing aids or cochlear implant. So you got a mechanical device, a cochlear implant or hearing aid, then you have a device, it's a telephone, and they're trying to hear you. So what I do is when I return a call, I'll just give you an example. When they say hello, here's my response. Hi, this is Caroline Lutke from the Office for the Deaf and Hard of Hearing. I am returning your call. Have you noticed I did not rush? I said it at a steady pace and clear speech. And most times it works. So during the conversation, use short, simple phrases, sentences. It makes it easier to follow. If you have to give numbers, please say each digit, like 414 instead of 414. And names and addresses. If you have to spell it out, please use code words like A as in apple, B as in boy, D as in dog. B and D sound the same to me on the phone. So I always verify, are you saying D as in dog or B as in boy? Next, repeat and rephrase. Do expect that. You will need to repeat, and please do. Next slide, please. Checking on time. Can you go ahead and click on that, please? Okay, the host will. Okay, thank you. We have created a handout, and this is a section on the handout on the second page, or you can be, if you print it front and back, it's on the back. And there's a part that says general communication tips. I am not gonna review all of them just to save time. Some of them that's already been shared earlier by the previous presenters. And I just want to point out that it's very important to make sure you get the person's attention before speaking. That's a biggie right there. Most people make this common mistake. You need to get the person's attention. And we're practicing safe distance. We got face masks. They're not gonna hear you. And you're calling someone's name, they're not gonna hear you. And so you know that's the person you need to get in contact with, wave. Look at the person, eye contact, and once you're connected, perfect. Gesture, come forward if you need to go in another room, whatever it means, but use visual aid, it's gestures, okay? Now, as you're working with a person with a hearing loss, you wanna make sure you maintain eye contact. It shows respect, but it also connection. Because you want to avoid filling out forms and reading while talking because you broke that eye contact because you're looking at something else. We can't tell that you're saying something. But I have noticed some masks and you can tell them when it's actually speaking, but they're not speaking towards you because they're looking away. So you can tell the mask is doing more than breathing. So we would say, or in my case, I actually had to tell someone, could you please repeat what you said? Because I wasn't sure if you were asking me a question or not. Another big tip is to please speak naturally. Do not shout. Shouting is hard to understand because your speech is distorted. And as you shout, your body language mirrors that because you're not showing as a pleasant person. You're looking like you're angry. So avoid that. So speak naturally and calmly and be sure to state topic first before having a conversation. Topic helps. And if you have more than one subject, do one subject at a time. Please go back to the PowerPoint, please. I want to explain more why it's very important to be patient. We cannot emphasize it enough that you need to be patient when you're working with consumers who are deaf and hard of hearing, especially if you are wearing face masks and social distancing. Patience is very, very important because it takes time to communicate. This is not something that you can rush. If you rush, we're lost, okay? So when you're communicating with someone, you need to be sure to provide extra time to work with the individual. People with hearing loss are constantly filling in the gaps. I'm always filling in the gaps every time I'm hearing something on TV or when I'm out in social groups, and even more so when there's face mask. When there's noisy environment or a nearby conversation, it makes it very difficult to follow. And if you find yourself that somebody is constantly saying, please repeat, I didn't get that, I didn't hear you, you may find yourself that may say, never mind, or it's not important. That's considered a communication breakdown. Don't do those. Do not use any of the communication breakdowns because it causes the individual with the hearing loss to feel like they're not important. Don't do those. Next slide, please. Here's a nice visual example that most individuals with hearing loss have difficulty hearing high frequency sounds. High frequency sounds letters are S, T, H, T, F, K. Those letters have been removed from the sentence below. As you are reading those sentences below, have you noticed there's no topic? That makes it even more difficult to know what that is. And if you try to read it, it's mumbling. You may catch one word or two. And this is a good example where you can say, I heard you, but I did not understand a word you said. Couldn't follow. So though you're still trying to figure out what that is, I'll give you an answer right now. If Kathy and Sally are sisters, they love to collect flowers and fly a kite. Next slide, please. So effective communication is a shared responsibility. Please remember that. Don't assume that people with hearing loss who use the same mode of communication. It varies from one person to another, it's individual. So if someone who is hard of hearing, you don't know sign language, you wouldn't give a sign language interpreter in place. If someone who's deaf, you would not give Braille, okay? So it is individual based, but always ask for what's the best mode of communication. And if you're not sure what to do, ask. It's okay. Next slide. I believe, due to time. Could you please go ahead and provide a third poll question, please? Okay. It looks like most of you got it right. It's 97% is any of these options depending on the individual involved. That is correct. It depends on the individual. Thank you. You guys are very good listeners. The takeaway slide is pretty straightforward. So treat the customer with the disability the same courtesy, patient respect as other customers, and do take the consumer's lead when it comes to preferred language and method of communication. Next slide, please. Thank you so much for your time. And I hope that this information that we have given you has been very helpful. And the next slide is a resource slide just for you to check out. Please do review them. Especially the last one, a visual communication tool. We have a COVID-19 communication card that's a point to the picture approach. I have one with me right here that consumers can get a copy of this from our office. And there's also emergency preparedness toolkit communication tool that first responders actually really love to have a copy in their to-go bag. So Thank you, everyone.
Thank you very much to our presenters. And don't worry, panel or attendees, we will be sending out these slides and all of the resources to you as well. And now we have about 5 minutes for our Q&A with the panelists. And in addition to our presenters, I also want to introduce another panelist that's joining us today, Heather Stelges. Heather is a disability access consultant for the Division of Extension, but also for UW-Madison at McBurney Disability Resource Center, focusing on equal access through disability accommodations. And she has worked in the field of disability access, inclusion, and education for over 15 years. If you do have questions for our panelists while I bring them all up on our screen, please go ahead and add those to the Q&A feature that you see at the bottom of your screen. And I did see that we had one question in already. So let me go ahead and read that for our panelists. My question is related to eye contact. Do you suggest direct eye contact with all cultures? I know there are some cultures who feel direct eye contact is a sign of disrespect. So wondering if you would suggest for those with hearing loss, wondering what you would suggest for those with hearing loss from those cultures.
Betty? Okay, I will share one. I am not an expert in other cultural groups, but I have noticed when I used to work at a private school a long time ago, I used to be an art teacher. And as an individual with a hearing loss, I like eye contact because that way we're in connection. But I've had students, 80% of the students at the school where I was working at were African Americans, and they did not like to give eye contact in initial. So yes, there are some cultural differences with eye contact for certain reasons. So I cannot give you a solid answer, but I have noticed there is a difference from one culture to another.
I'll add on to that just from a larger disability perspective is that eye contact the question is absolutely right, is that it's a very American society standard. And so with that in mind, there are folks who are autistic or on the autism spectrum where eye contact is a barrier. And so keeping that in mind as well. So it's a great question. I think that's the aspect of keeping eye contact is also gathering additional information from your consumer or your client. And so if somebody is not making eye contact, I think, you can use that information as you continue to work with them as well.
About 1 minute left.
Yeah, and somebody asked about the COVID card and how to get that card. And you can actually contact ODHH, and Caroline's the lead on that. And so she can actually explain how people can get that card.
Yes, individuals, any consumers who are deaf and hard of hearing wish to have a copy of the COVID-19 communication card. All they have to do is send me an email, and the subject line can say COVID-19 card, and they just send me an address, their mailing address. All I have to do is send it. No cost. I've had a few testing sites that wants a stack of them, but I do let them know that they do need to be laminated, because if you need to clean it, you're going to have to get it laminated to disinfect it. And so I have sent stacks out to testing sites. So there's options.
And we have one more question that came in. I see we're right at two, but let's definitely go ahead and answer this. If a family member wants to interpret, how can you suggest another interpreter without insulting them?
Can you say that question again, please?
Yes, and let me go ahead and spotlight you too, Carly. If a family member wants to interpret, how can you suggest another interpreter without insulting them?
Well, this is Jennifer Anderson. This is can be a sticky situation. Whoever, we can't force the individual. Really, it's the patient or the deaf individual's choice. So we can't force it, but we definitely encourage that. And we say, you know, would you like us to secure a different interpreter? We just want to make sure that the interpreter is there for whatever you need. But it is their choice and their right if they want to use a family member, but we just don't suggest it. I don't know if Caroline or Bette wanted to add something to that.
I want to add something. I think it's really a bad idea. And I would say, well, you know, we can provide an interpreter, professional interpreter for you, free of charge. Make sure the person understands they don't have to pay for it. If they still want to use that family member, I would still be careful because the family member going to interpret everything. Are they going to edit? Are they going to even give the person the message correctly? Are they going to voice accurately? Or, I mean, who knows what's going on in that household? So those are the reasons why it's not a good idea. I've worked with hospitals in the past where this has come up and deaf patient wanted to have a family member interpret. Okay, the deaf person was required to sign a waiver saying that they preferred to have the family member interpret, and they would have been offered the services of a professional interpreter free of charge, and they have denied it because you want to make sure that you're covered too. Because the interpreter is for both the hearing provider and the deaf person. So I don't think that's a bad idea at all.
Thank you so much to our presenters and our panelists. We are going to wrap up the webinar today with one final poll. For our final poll, we ask that you please provide the following demographic information about yourself. This information is used to ensure our programming is reaching a diversity of audiences and to fulfill our obligations as a recipient of federal funding. You reserve the option not to provide this demographic information, and should you choose not to provide this information, you can please select prefer not to respond. And thank you again to all of our amazing presenters. We've had some accolades come in from the chat box, and thank you to all of our attendees for joining us today. As we mentioned, a recording of this webinar will be shared on Extension's COVID response website. We'll send out an email with a link to that recording, along with tons of resources from our colleagues at the Office for the Deaf and Hard of Hearing, and also a copy of these slides as well. So again, thank you to everyone, and have an exceptional afternoon.